Good afternoon. Welcome everybody to our UC Ag Expert Talk today. My name is Cheryl Reynolds. I'm with the UC Statewide IPM program. Peter Cusina is also here with us. He's going to be running our polls and troubleshooting our technical problems that might come up. Please note that Peter and I are working from our homes, and so this may affect the quality of our audio connection. Please note that today's webinar is targeted to growers and agricultural pest management professionals. Master gardeners can certainly benefit from participating, but the pest management methods presented, especially the pesticides, are not to be followed without a clear understanding of their legal use in home environments. Okay, so at this point, I would like to introduce our speaker today. We have David Haviland. He is a farm advisor with the UC Cooperative Extension in Kern County and specializing in entomology and pest management. And today he is speaking on mites in citrus. So now I'm going to pass this over to David, and you can go ahead and share your slides.
Okay, well, good afternoon. Is that working well, Cheryl?
Yes, we can see it.
Perfect, thank you. So good afternoon. I've got to say, I'm pretty excited to be here, but at the same time, a little bit intimidated. Looking at that survey just a minute ago, first of all, seeing that half of you are from Southern California. Most of my experience is in the Valley, so I'll do my best to represent the South. But also just looking at the number of people in your experience, my simple math suggests there might be guys somewhere from, you know, 2,000 to 2,500 years of experience, by PCAs and growers that are on this webinar related to citrus. So, that's a lot of experience from a lot of you, and I will do my best to try and sort of walk through just mites and citrus in California, because there's a lot of them. And the invitation I got is pretty much just a kind of an entry level. What are the mites? Kind of how do you identify them? What's the damage they do? Maybe where are they found in the state? And then an overview, just sort of on a simple level on how they're managed. So hopefully by the end of this webinar, all of you will be able to say, these are, the 10 or so mites that are most common to be found in citrus in California, where they're found, and know something about them. That way when you're maybe looking at a pesticide label and, you see all these mites listed, you can know which ones are relevant and which ones aren't, both for you, wherever you may be farming in California or somewhere else in the state. So this is what I'm going to cover today. I'm going to sort of walk through each one of these. Some like citrus red mite are something that most people are going to be familiar with. Some of the ones toward the end, like bud mite or six-spotted mite, I'll go through very quickly, trying to give a sort of proportionate amount of time to the ones that are more important across the state. I am going to have, I think it's 8 quiz questions along the way. That's just how it works to get your 1-hour DPR credit. So I'll be asking those after some of the major mites here and then going through the answers there. Hopefully you can all be listening and get them all right. That's the goal. So without further ado, just to start out, citrus red mite, this is the sort of the most common mite that's known in citrus, and citrus is the only host compared to some other things, other mites like like two-spotted mites that go to lots of different crops. So this is your classic, red and black, dark colored mite that when you smash it, leaves a little red stain on your finger or on the leaf. Very easy to identify. The other key identification thing for this particular mite, if you look down here in the right corner, I don't know if you're actually going to be able to see it on this picture, but the eggs in particular, got a round colored egg, sort of dark. There's this little seta, little hair that sticks up off the top of it. You may or may not be able to see that on your screen, but with a hand lens, you can definitely see that. So red and black mite, it's kind of got those white dots on the back and then the dark colored eggs with the little hair coming up from it. This particular mite can go from egg to adult in about 12 days in the summer. Of course, not in the winter, but at its peak, it can reproduce pretty quickly. But this mite in particular responds to new growth. So it really likes a newer, tender leaves. Responds to that. And the highest populations you'll get will be in the spring. They sort of die off in the summer, and then they're back in the late summer and the early fall. Hey, really quick, Cheryl. So while I give this presentation, I'm not going to be monitoring the Q&A. If you wouldn't mind, if you see one of those that's worth stopping and addressing, feel free to chime in and ask me that, okay?
Okay, yes, we'll do that.
Great, thank you. So the damage from this particular species is, I kind of listed all these out because it's typical for a lot of mites. So most mites, or all the mites we're going to talk about, they have stylets. So their mouth part is basically two little needles that'll stick out of the mouth. And what they do is they take these little needles and they thrust them down into the surface of the leaf tissue or fruit or whatever whatever the tissue is, and they poke holes in the cells. So, stab, 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 poke the holes in the cells, the contents from those cells will leak out and they drink those up. So if you get one poke mark on one cell, you end up with what we call a stipple. There's one little teeny tiny yellowish spot where a cell died. Well, as you get two of those, three of those, four of those, and so on, the one little stipple mark turns into a larger stippled area, that eventually can become larger and larger and larger to the point that you get larger, kind of scabbier, darker areas. And at some point, when too many of those cells are punctured, the tree's just going to say, this leaf isn't pulling its weight. It's not making what it should be as far as, photosynthesis is concerned. So I'm done putting any resources in this leaf, and it sheds the leaf. So you get defoliation. So that's kind of classic with most mites. So you've got, stippling on the leaves, leaf drop. When you lose leaves, of course, you can sunburn fruit. As you lose a lot of leaves, you can also get twig dieback, from sunburn and other reasons. You can get fruit stippling from this. And then in severe cases, you can actually have fruit drop and discoloration from this mite, but it takes quite a few to do that. And then we're gonna talk about several mites about leaf blasting. So spider mites, when they sort of weaken a leaf and you get some stippling on it, where the leaf's not quite doing what it should, for several of the mites we talk about, when you get these really hot, dry Santa Ana winds, particularly late in the summer, the trees are stressed, you've kind of lost some water in the soil profile. Leaves on citrus trees are very prone to falling off under those conditions. So that's something to watch out for. So, but the cool thing about this mite is that the damage during the summer, when there's no new flush, it really is minimal. The mite does tend to go away. So just a summary of management. First of all, avoiding tree stress whenever possible. So a good, healthy tree defends itself against this mite. And then this is a case of conservation biocontrol. So I'm going to use this term conservation biocontrol a lot in this webinar. So what this means is essentially avoiding pesticides that kill the good bugs. Okay, that's what we mean by conservation biocontrol. So predatory mites and several other generalist predators, I'll cover the predators a little bit later on towards the end, are very good against this mite and keep it in pretty good check. So simple summary of management, in March, if you're in the San Joaquin Valley, you're gonna start monitoring for these mites about every 2 weeks. There's a program on the UCIPM website. I'm sure Peter along the way can keep putting posts for where to find the UCIPM website and the citrus guidelines there. Very easy to find, but there's a program on the website. You essentially count the number of mites. You make an assessment on how much biocontrol there is and the virus. And then there's a threshold of 6 to 8 mites per leaf. So regarding the virus, if you look at the picture in the bottom right, it's actually really, really cool. Just like people can get a coronavirus, this particular mite can get its own virus. And the virus gets inside the mite, it starts to grow. And if you look at the picture on the bottom right, you can see the little, these little things, they actually grow out of the mite itself. So you can see this sort of dried up, shriveled mite with these little growths coming out of its back. That means that the virus got it. So it's pretty awesome. This is the only mite I know of, at least in citrus. Actually, it's kind of the only one I know of in any major crop that gets a virus like this. So that's pretty awesome. So again, start in March, every couple of weeks until the mites go away, you'll want to monitor and make some treatment decisions. And then if you're in the Southern California or coastal areas, it's a little different. In that case, you're actually monitoring in the fall. And the guidelines UC has is you should treat if you're above that 8 to 10 per leaf threshold in the fall. If your trees are stressed, if you're anticipating a Santa Ana wind event, sort of a trifecta of all these things come together is when you really want to be careful. Otherwise, for the most part, biocontrol does pretty good. Now, if you're going to treat, I'm just going to keep it simple here. This is a trial by Beth Grafton Cardwell. And you can see here, April and May, this April-ish is when a typical treatment timing would be in the San Joaquin Valley. And you can see the numbers here, the water check on the top, and at the bottom, just to simplify, Fujimite, Zeal, Envidor, Movento, Agrimec, Canamite in this particular trial, all knock this mite down to very low numbers compared to the water check. This is not by any means an exhaustive list. Most miticides that we have, most modern day miticides, really are specialists on spider mites, and citrus red mite is a spider mite. So lots and lots of choices available, these ones as well as others that are on the UCIPM website. All right, on we go, Texas citrus mite. So Texas citrus mite, I'm gonna cover in a little more detail because it's one that can be a big problem and was this last year in isolated cases. So Texas citrus mite, it has, I guess the easy way to identify is it has really, really long legs. You can see the male right here in the center of the screen, really long legs. Male in the bottom right, females in the top right. And you can see that when they sit on the leaf, they tend to put four legs forward and four legs backwards. Females are a little bit darker. The eggs on the bottom left, they look like a squashed football. So imagine if you took a football, rammed it into the surface of the leaf on its point end so that the points kind of got smashed toward the middle to make it a little more donut shaped. And that's pretty much what the eggs look like. They start out a little on the amber side. And then if you see those ones on the bottom, you can see they're sort of bicolor. That's what they look like relatively shortly before they start to hatch. Now, this particular mite will go to all types of citrus. Personally, I've seen it in oranges, tangelos, grapefruits, mandarins. It's been in the Coachella Valley for decades. I don't know a whole lot about its prevalence in the Coachella Valley. Sorry about that. My experience with it's in the San Joaquin Valley. And in the southern part of the San Joaquin Valley, there's a definite pattern with this mite. So in Kern County, we see it in Edison area, General Beale area, 166 area, and I've seen it in the Bell Ridge area also. I've also heard rumblings of it on the east side of Tulare County. But really what we see on this chart on the right is that this mite shows up November and December, end of October, in areas that have early fruit production. So what's happening is in these areas, you've got, Fukumoto's, Fisher's, some of these early navels and other crops where prices are looking really, really good in October, November. The growers are pulling back water to try and force the sugars to increase, essentially stressing the tree. And so this deficit irrigation, I'll call it regulated deficit irrigation, that's stressing these trees to bring up sugars. If you get a Santa Ana hot wind type of event that comes through, the mites just thrive in that. And so in this case, you get the leaf stippling. There's actually no webbing. So this mite is a little different than others. You will not see any webbing at all. You'll just see the mites. So you got to look for them. But the typical symptom is called rat tailing. If you look at the top picture on the right, you'll see a couple of the leaves, the actual blade fell off, but the petiole is still stuck there. And if you look at the picture on the bottom right, this is what we call rat tailing. You get these tips or whips that kind of shoot up the top where the blades have fallen off, but the petioles are stuck behind, kind of like a rat's tail sticking up in the air. That is absolute classic Texas citrus mite. Now, when you start losing leaves, if you have that stress plus a Santa Ana wind, there can be significant actual fruit drop. So not just stippling of fruit, but actually the tree will start to abort fruit. As far as fruit stippling, it can occur, but that's not normally the biggest concern. So, one other thing. This particular mite is really, really loves the outside canopy. It's not one that hides in the middle. It's really out in out where the sun is. So just a couple close-up pictures. Here's that. Here's the blade that blade's falling off with the petiole stuck behind. You can see a little bit of discoloration on the fruit to the top left. You know, a lot of this fruit, of course, that's picked in October, November, early December. You know, a lot of this is being picked quite on the green side once there's minimum sugars and then being gassed to color. So there's some concerns that if you have some stippling on the fruit, they may not gas up quite as orange, you know, uniform orange as you want. But generally speaking, that's not the biggest issue. Again, here's the close-up of the top of the tree. And then, so as far as management, you know, first of all, I'm going to say prevention. Regulated deficit irrigation does not mean stress the heck out of a tree. Okay, so, you know, pulling back the water some is fine, but pulling it back too much with hot, dry weather, with a depleted soil water profile, that's where you're going to get yourself into problems in these early harvested areas. And as far as weather goes, this particular mite's interesting. It can tolerate quite cold weather. It can tolerate a warm rain. But the absolute first night that there's a cold fog, you know, the leaves are wet all night with cold fog, dead. 100% of these mites by morning, they're just drowned dead on the leaf surface. So a lot of times what growers will do is they'll just watch their fields, watch the mites, but watch the weather. You know, if there's going to be a little rain, some cooler weather and the fog coming in real soon, done, walk away, not a problem. You know, if you're still a few weeks away from harvest and you're going to be water stressing your trees, again, you know, Edison, General Beale areas, that's a case where miticides can be used. I'll just say all miticides that have ever been tested work. This mite's a total wuss. You know, anything can kill it, including oil alone if you want to take that option. And outside coverage is okay. So don't be doing a scale treatment at hundreds of gallons. I mean, literally 100, 150 gallons of water, driving fairly quick, covering the outside periphery of the trees, kind of like a thrip spray, will do great on this mite. All right, next, this is a lesser known mite called Yuma spider mite. It's a very round species and a very orange species. So just a uniform orangish color, the mites as well as the eggs. You can see the eggs on the top right, perfect spheres and orange color. In the San Joaquin Valley, I've seen this mostly on mandarins, but it also, this mite is also present in the Coachella Valley. The damage in this case is just stippling, okay? I don't know a whole lot about, not a whole lot's known about the biology that I've been able to find, but it does feed on leaves. Definitively, it does feed on fruit. And you can see the pictures I took there of some mandarins. These pictures were actually taken late summer on mandarin varieties where the growers rightfully were very, very concerned that when they picked this fruit early and gassed it for color, that the color was not going to be right. So rightfully so. You can see on that bottom picture on the right, the difference between stippled leaves versus new fresh green leaves. So this, so this can cause a defoliation, but that's not really the biggest concern. The biggest concern is really just the stunting and the color of the fruit. In fact, you can see that picture on the bottom right, you know, that fruit is hammered. That fruit is heavily stippled, as are the leaves, but you can see there's not actually no defoliation. The leaves are still there. So they can come off, but it takes a lot to do that. The other problem is if you get this mite on second, third, fourth leaf young trees, the stunting can be significant that it actually, you know, affects the growth. So as I said, I don't know a lot about the biology of this mite. I'm just going to share with you what's in the University of California guidelines, but then also what my observations have been in the valley. The guidelines are based mostly on Southern California. And the guidelines down there on the left side, you can see this mite's mainly on grapefruits and lemons, reported from Coachella and Imperial Valley. Down there, it's most numerous in the winter and in the late spring. The damage, sometimes there's leaf drop, but treatments are rarely needed. Sulfur, you know, October to March can take it out down in the southern part of the state. Now, my observations in the San Joaquin Valley is that it behaves a little different. It's not common by any means. Actually, it's fairly rare, but it can be really bad, like in the pictures I showed you. So everywhere that I've seen it in the valley has been on murcots and clementines. It's all been mandarin varieties. And I haven't looked on other mandarin varieties. It might be that all mandarins get it. Maybe just these are the ones I've seen. But in particular, that's where to look for it. I have seen it in both Kern and Tulare counties. But in the valley, it's most numerous mid to late summer. So this is really a October, September to October pest. In that case, the severe stippling that I showed you in the pictures and on the fruit, and foliar miticides in this case may be required. We did some trials, and this is a while ago, and we're talking almost 15 years ago now. But just want to point out, most miticides, they work. Yuma spider mite is a spider mite. And as I said earlier, these products are all formulated to be good against spider mites. So, Agromec, Envidor, Fujimite, Canamite, Nexter, Onager, Vendex, Zeal, all were effective. Danitol was also effective. Of course, a pyrethroid. We try to avoid pyrethroids in citrus, but if there's a reason you have to use it, it can help with this mite. Interesting for us down there, third from the bottom, was dusting sulfur. It was relatively hot when we did this trial in August, but we didn't get good control with dusting sulfur. That, of course, is what the guidelines say is a common practice in Southern California. For us, it didn't really work in the valley. I can't explain why. It is what it is. One more trial, same kind of thing. You can see down here in the bottom, the untreated checks were, in the 4 to 5 mites per leaf range. And all of the products we tested that you can see there all dropped the mites down to almost nothing. So not a very difficult mite to control. The question is just, do you need to control it? There's no treatment thresholds for it. No university guideline that says when you do it, don't need to treat. You just have to watch. If you start seeing mites in the late summer, especially on mandarins in the valley, if you're seeing the mites, if it's that uniform orange color, you can ID it as a Yuma spider mite. You know it's probably going to be at its peak in August, September, October, late in the year. Keep your eye on it. And if it looks like it's getting to the point that the stippling is unacceptable on the leaves or on the fruit, then consider making a treatment. Okay, two-spotted spider mite. So two-spotted spider mite is one of those universal mites that you find, on hundreds and hundreds of different crops. It's not common on citrus, but it can, it can be there. So this particular mite overwinters on the tree. Sometimes it'll be under the button, it'll be, in the navel, but in particular, it likes where two fruit touch each other. And you can see this picture on the right here. Spider mites, in this case, two-spotted spider mite. One of the reasons they call them spider mites is because of the webbing they produce. And you can see there how they love to just form little bridges between where two fruit touch each other. This is great for them because they can feed at the surface of the fruit, but then they can also lay all their eggs and things. Lay all their eggs inside that webbing. It's like taking a one-dimensional surface area and turning it into a skyscraper where they can put all their eggs. The webbing's also good because it provides some sort of protection from some of the predators that would try to feed on them. So, during the winter in citrus, they'll feed all winter. For those of you that have grown almonds or other crops where the leaves come off in the winter, in those areas, the mites go into diapause. Okay, so you can't find these mites in almonds, for example, right now. In fact, you won't be able to see them till March. But in the citrus where the leaves don't come off, yes, they are active all winter. You can find all the life stages. And this third bullet down here, this is just, I pulled this out of my notes from a field visit. January 30th, saw adult females, eggs, and larvae on over 90% of fruit that either touched each other in Kern County mandarin. That happened to be a murcot down off Highway 166. So right now, they can be quite prevalent. And what happens from it? They do feed on leaves, but you can also get the shoulders stippled or where the fruit touch each other stippled. And that can cause some discoloration during waxing the packing shed. At least that was the biggest concern by the growers, is what the fruit would look like eventually. Now, as the season moves on, the activity tends to pick up in the late spring and summer. Even though those mites were, of course, damaging late fruit, you know, let's say a murcott, that particular field, I think, was getting harvested in March or maybe even April. But this mite really likes it later in the year, which would be after harvest for anything but a, you know, summer harvested Valencia or something like that. So, you know, as you get into the summer, this pest can just take off, loves plant stress, loves dust. As far as identification, just want to point out that the colors can be really variable depending on what they feed on. If they're feeding on leaves in the summer, they'll be sort of a traditional sort of tan colored with these dark feeding spots on the back, those kind of black spots. They're internal inside the body, not, you know, not on the top, but you can see them there in the, in, you know, right here. So these black spots, but you can see this one's sort of an orangish color. You know, this male here, bright orange. You can see the immature stages here are, you know, in this case are more of an ambery color. They can be greener. Again, it just depends on what they're feeding on. So don't let the color confuse you. But those two spots are almost always present, at least in the females. And this is, again, as I said, lots of webbing associated with this mite. So that can help you with identification. So what do you do with spider mite control? Generally speaking, it's not needed. You know, biological control is pretty good. Lots of things like to feed on spider mites. Trees can tolerate a little bit of stippling in the summer. And, you know, when there's no fruit, fruit's small, you know, not a big deal. So, you know, generally, yeah, treatments aren't needed. University of California doesn't have any treatment thresholds or guidelines that say this is how many mites justify a treatment. As far as timings, again, not really well defined. I mean, obviously, if you're coming out of the winter in the San Joaquin Valley and you're seeing webbing between fruit and you've got a couple months for harvest, yeah, time to treat. But again, specific guidelines for the best time are just don't exist. And we don't have any insecticide trials in citrus that I'm aware of, but I'll just tell you, two-spotted spider mite is one of those universal targets of pretty much every miticide. You know, they're pests in strawberries, they're pests in beans, they're pests in almonds, tons of, you know, stone fruits, tons and tons of crops. So pretty much any miticide that has spider mites listed on it, you'll see two spots, specific spider mite. Those are going to be effective on this particular pest. So if you're going to pick a miticide, you know, just pick one that's as soft as possible on the beneficials. Citrus flat mite. So citrus flat mite is something that most citrus growers are not going to be familiar with, but that every pistachio grower knows. So in pistachios, this particular mite feeds on the rachis. And as there's more and more feeding on the rachis will dry out and all the nuts in the cluster below that point will shrivel. Now the best, you know, why am I talking about pistachios and citrus? The good thing about citrus flat mite and pistachios is we know it is extremely easy to control. Pistachio growers just put out one sulfur application in the summer and this mite is gone. Okay, absolutely does not tolerate sulfur. So why do we care about citrus flat mite and citrus? The main reason is this particular mite likes wounds, okay? It's associated with wounds on the surface of the rind and the fruit in particular. So it'll live under the button. Again, yeah, not a major problem right now, but it's extremely important to be aware that this mite that we have, and there's plenty of it out there, you just don't really notice it, is the vector for a disease called citrus leprosis. So citrus leprosis is a very nasty disease of citrus. It's down in Southern Central America. I just heard it's spreading towards California. I'm not sure how close it is, you know, how far from our border. But if that disease, the citrus leprosis disease, were actually to show up here in California, we have plenty of citrus flat mite that disease would be a problem. So we want to make sure we never, ever get it. Now, what does the damage look like? This is a severe, severe, severe case of flat mite damage. It's really hard to get damage this bad, but here's sort of how it works. You know, as I said, flat mites like fruit that's damaged already. So if you have a lot of stippling by leafhoppers, or a lot of scarring by citrus thrips, or sandblasting. So sometimes you'll get a crazy nasty windstorm in a sandy area where the fruit down in the bottom couple feet of the tree will get just sort of sandblasted by that blowing sand. Any of those things that damage the rind on the surface, the flat mite just goes right to the damage spot, feeds, proliferates, and you can get this crazy damage, you know, scarring damage on the surface of the fruit. One thing to point out, if you start looking at the fruit, is the damage always tends to be opposite of the attachment site. So, if you see in the bottom right picture, you can see how it looks pretty green up where the fruit's attached. The damage gets worse toward the other end. As you start looking at the pictures on the top right and start figuring out which fruit is top up and bottom up, you'll see that pattern. Leafhopper damage will be more uniform. Thrips damage, of course, will be more towards where the flower end, towards the top as they're feeding bloom just after bloom. So again, scarring, bottom end of the fruit, and you'll see these little red mites on it. That's flat mite damage. But again, it's pretty rare to get this kind of, it has to be sort of everything goes wrong to get damage this bad. So as far as management goes, as I said, the flat mites are known for making thrips, leafhopper, or wind and sand damage worse. So anything that's done to control the amount of scarring or stippling from those other pests will help prevent flat mite damage. You want to monitor for flat mites July to September if you're in an area that's prone to a history. For example, if you had some scarring last year, then you probably want to watch this year from July to September. And the university guidelines, they say, treat when you've got a high mite number, or treat when high mite numbers appear, and monitoring for fruit scarring indicates a need. So that's pretty darn vague, but that's the reality. If there's no fruit scarring, you don't care. If you're starting to see some fruit scarring and a lot of mites, then consider doing something. Again, there are no thresholds for this mite, but based on our experience from pistachios, it's very, very easy to control with sulfur. So whatever sulfur you're comfortable with based on, the time of year and temperatures and the fruit you've got. But with all of that, again, most growers don't need to deal with it, but if you do, it's easy to control until, of course, and hopefully that's how things stay, that we don't get the disease. Okay, broad mites. We're making good progress here. So broad mites, this is a pest if you grow lemons on the coast. Oftentimes, the best way to define this mite is you see it on the surface of the fruit. And you see the top picture on the right. They like to hide in the little dimples, those little depressions that are on the surface. And from a size perspective, if you can think about how big those little dimple pores are, you can imagine how small these mites are. The eggs are actually totally unique to other spider mite or to other eggs. Sorry, this is not a spider mite. It's a whole different kind of mite. But the egg in the cutout down below. So the eggs are sort of translucent with these little white spots on the surface. They're also in the dimples on the surface of the fruit, the best place to find them. And the mites are, you can see on the top, they're sort of yellowish. They've got, the adult females have a stripe that goes down the middle of their top. You can't quite see it right here, but depending on how good your screen resolution is, there's this sort of white line that goes from head to tail right down the top of the mite. So that's identification. What's the damage? So broad mite feeds on fruit and leaves, and really this mite likes humid, warm, humid weather. So when you've got this warm, humid weather, lots of mites, and they like to feed on succulent growth. So brand new small fruit, especially inside the canopy where there's more humidity, they'll feed on that small fruit. And then as that fruit expands, you'll get a scarring that becomes permanent. Once you've got that scarring, if it's severe, you're gonna get, of course, cracking and so on. But once you've got that scarring, there's nothing you can do about it. So this is really one of those pests where you need to identify the damage early and take care of it, if you need to take care of it. In most cases, you don't need to. Also, broad mite will feed on the brand new leaves. And when it does, those new leaves will be deformed and you'll get the sort of twisting, curling of the new leaves, kind of like leaf miner will cause, except you won't see any of those little mines in the new leaves. So again, if you see that curling of the leaves, you may not even see the mites because the mites are probably long gone and actually fed on those leaves right as they were coming out. So management of broad mites, again, only needed in lemons on the coast. And typically it's a late July to early October that management would be needed. You've got, you know, warm weather and the mites like that. One point about broad mite is there is some decent biocontrol for them normally. And anywhere you've got a lot of Argentine ants, you're more likely to have more broad mite problems. And that's going to be, you know, normally when you think of lots of ants, we think of problems with scale, you know, soft scales, mealy bugs, red scale, and so on. But in the case, in this case, Argentine ants can also make the broad mite problems worse. Now, from a university standpoint, we don't have any treatment thresholds. Our guidelines just say that if you're choosing a miticide, you know, if you see damage from last year, you're seeing mites, you see some scarring starting on some small fruit, just choose a miticide. Choose one that has least toxicity to predatory mites that are important, and got to treat. UC suggests abamectin and oil as the most common product. It does well. Spider diclofen also works, which would be Envidor, and there's a few other products listed in the guidelines, I believe, including sulfur. I'd have to double check. I'm not quite as familiar with this mite. But that's sort of broad mite in a nutshell for the coastal lemon growers. So rust mite, we just got a couple left here, so I'm running out of time. So citrus rust mite and silver mite. So citrus rust mite, this is what we call this in oranges. Silver mite's what we call it in lemons, but it's the same thing. So this is an areophyid mite, which are these long, slender, just tiny, 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 not visible with the naked eye mites. This is the number, one of the number top pests. I shouldn't call it number one, but a top pest, if not number one, in Florida on the citrus there. Really likes their humid conditions. California, very, very rare for it to reach pest status. And it's mainly just in the coastal areas. So here's just some pictures you can see of some scarring of the surface of fruit. With different levels of, on the top right of the lemons, you can see why they call it silver mite, because that silver color of the fruit. And then on the bottom, same exact pests, you can see why they call it rust mite in oranges, because of that rust colored scabbing that's on the surface of the fruit. And that's just because of the feeding and the impact it has on the rind. As far as management, again, I'm just going kind of quick on the last few here. You're just monitoring the new leaves in the early spring and then fruit in the late spring. In lemons, need to monitor year round because of course the way the fruit is produced. Oftentimes though, you're really gonna know if you have a problem with these mites based on last year's harvest. So if you're clean last year, you're probably good this year. If you had problems last year, be more diligent with the monitoring. And you know, if scarring occurs and some pesticides are needed, there's several available. And there's details, more details about that on the university's pest management guidelines. Three mites super fast here. So Kanzawa mite, it's also known as hydrangea mite. I don't know a whole lot about it. Just to say, you know, it's been in Southern California since about 2002 is when it was first found. It's very similar to two-spotted spider mite, makes lots and lots of webbing and scars the fruit. Observations I've heard is that it's most problematic in September, October, but being a spider mite, pretty much anything that controls spider mites should do a good job controlling it. I just don't know at what point you do or don't need to treat it. I know Joe Morse was sort of observed some of those. In fact, some of the pictures that we have from UC, Joe Barcina sent in, I know he's been involved with this mite, but that's what it is. If you're down in Southern California and see something with a lot of webbing, don't just assume it's two spot because it may not be. It might be this Kunzala mite. Citrus bud mite. This is another one of those coastal lemons mites. It's another area five, okay, those long skinny ones. In this case, the eggs are put in the bud scales. They hatch, they feed inside the buds. This can actually kill the bud, or if the bud survives, you'll end up with a distorted fruit or flower. And then as you can see on the bottom right, you get all kinds of odd shaped fruit. Now, how big of a problem is this? You know, if it's some of the UC information, there's been trials that 80% of the buds were infested and it was a non-issue. There's other cases where you might have 10% of your fruit misshapen, but if you're just making lemonade out of it, you know, not a big deal. So you just sort of have to balance what's your intention for the lemons? You know, are you going for export big, large fruit, or, or are you more on the juice side? And then what's the market? What kind of prices you think you're going to get? Based on all that, it's up to you to decide whether or not you think something needs to be done. But if you do something, typically sprays, though rare, need to be probably 2 to 3 months before bloom. Okay? Once the buds or once the mites are in the bud scales and then in the bud and then in the flower, you've lost the battle. You're not going to get it out of there. You kind of have to prevent it early on. So if you see damage this year, consider whether or not you need to do something next year. But again, sprays are quite rare. Okay, and then the last of the pest mites. Six-spotted mite. This is another one you sometimes will see in coast regions. This one is lemon. Okay, lemon, uniform lemon yellow color. That's got some spots on the back. They tend to feed right on the midrib. And as they feed on the, right by the midrib on the underside of the leaf, they'll cause an actual depression in the leaf that will cause a little bubble that sticks up on the top of the leaf. So if you see a little bulge on the top and the yellow mites underneath, that's what it is. Treatments, extremely, extremely rare. I don't know if they're ever needed. Natural enemies typically do a good job on this. Pending natural enemy disruption. Okay, I've got a couple slides on predatory mites and then just a couple of quick final comments. So biocontrol, predatory mites, the most important one is Eustachys tularensis. So on the top right, you see it's these teardrop shaped mites. They got a point on one end, round in the back. They're typically sort of translucent. You can see right here, clear. And they're the ones running around on leaves, chasing mites to eat them. Now, the cool thing about this particular mite is it feeds on mites, but it also eats citrus thrips, it eats scale nymphs, it eats pollen, all the above. So this is something that's just around all year. There's always food for it. We always want to keep it around. We don't want to kill it, for not just for mite control, but for the control of lots of several insects also. Is other biocontrol of mites, just sort of across all the mite species, lacewing larvae are good. They'll eat the mites. Six-spotted thrips, you can see in the middle. This is a beneficial thrips that has these six spots. There's a small ladybug, you can see right here. This black beetle is a predator that specifically eats mites. And then there's a few other things like dusky wings. So you probably saw that theme throughout all the different mites I talked about, that biocontrol is extremely important. These are sort of the key predators along with the predatory mites that are providing that biocontrol. So keep them around. Okay, so just concluding comments here because we're at 4 o'clock. Just a couple of concluding comments. So I think you've probably seen some themes. First of all, the majority of the mite species that are out there, I mean, not the bud mites, but as far as the spider mites, the ones that feed on the leaves, they really do respond to water stress and they do respond to the Santa Ana winds. And that response isn't just that the mites do better, but it's also that trees are less tolerant of feeding by mites when they have this stress and they get desiccated. They will shed leaves, they will shed fruit. Do control most mites in most years. So I've used, again, that word conservation biocontrol several times, very important. Bullet three, extra vigilance for mites is warranted where invasive species necessitate the use of broad spectrum insecticides. So, you know, that's the broad mite comment from the coast. The more and more psyllid treatments, the more and more sharpshooter treatments and so on that we have, the more problems we're going to see with mites that previously were under good biocontrol that become problems again. And for more information, I'm just going to put the simple, you know, see the UCIPM pest management guidelines for citrus, free, available online. They've got some great info. At the same time, the pest management, the IPM for citrus book that UC puts out is very good at having more details on the biology of most, not all, but on most of these mites. If you really want to get into the weeds on, you know, things like alternate hosts, seasonal biology, and that kind of stuff, compared to the pest management guidelines, that their focus is really on the sort of the short version of what specifically needs to be done for management. So with that, just to conclude, thank you. I know that was a whirlwind tour. Hopefully everyone came away with a sort of appreciation for all the different mites that are out there and some general knowledge on each one. At the same time, I think you could recognize that I wasn't able to really go into detail into the on some of the major species. That may need to be something that we do on a future webinar where we just focus on two or three mites and really dig into it versus this overview. But thank you for those of you that came. Hope you appreciated this and that you continue to support UCIPM and all that they're doing to put these webinars together to watch now forever, or if you really want to see it again, I guess it'll be on YouTube. So thanks a lot, Cheryl and Peter, for the invitation. Appreciate it.
Thank you, David. Okay, so I will get to these questions.
Please, go for it.
All right. So the first one was, does the Eusaeus predatory mite also eat ACP eggs and or small nymphs?
The answer is, I don't know. I'd have to look that one up. I'm not familiar with that. I mean, it's a generalist predator. I would expect, my guess is that it would eat eggs just because of how much of a generalist predator it is. Eggs are a pretty easy target and ACP eggs are small down in the right size range. So I'm just guessing there that that's going to be a yes. As far as the nymphs and beyond, I'm just going to have to say, I don't know.
Okay. And I think you may have covered this, but just to confirm, is the Yuma mite only a problem on Mandarin?
So in the San Joaquin Valley, that's the only crop I've seen it on, or the only, you know, citrus crop I've seen it on. So I don't know. I'd have to rely on the, you know, 150 or so people here if they've seen it on anything else in the valley. And I'm not as familiar with it down in Southern California on exactly what it is, what it feeds on down there. You know, again, I'm unfortunately San Joaquin Valley centric in my citrus experience.
Okay, thank you. For the next one, is the flat mite an export issue?
Oh boy, it could be. I'm not, you know, I don't know if Rick or someone else that's on here might want to chime in on the chat. So there's several species of flat mites. I know that for example, there's a species of Brevipalpus that's in Chile on grapes. That's an export quarantine issue for grapefruit, for grapes, like table grapes, to the United States. So I know that certain species of Brevipalpus back and forth between countries can be problems, but exactly which species of Brevipalpus we have in California, I don't know. I know the Citrus Research Board's worked with Carl Childers and some others, to help define what the species are. You know, I'm not sure if we have Californicus or Lewisi or which one here, and maybe multiple. And as far as which countries would or would not allow fruit that have those mites, I don't know. Yeah, that'd be one of the, you know, Citrus Quality Council or CRB question. Okay. I try to stay out of the regulatory stuff, not my expertise.
All right, the next one is about broad mites. You said that broad mite needs humidity, but the worst damage, or at least what this person sees, seems to come in the fall when we are the driest. And I think this was from Ventura County. So they're asking any idea why.
Yeah, so absolutely my statement was true about humidity. I mean, if you really, really want broad mite problems, go into a greenhouse with misters. I mean, they thrive in that condition. So I mean, obviously coastal regions, even though it's dry, you know, you have to remember these mites are living within millimeters of the surface of a leaf. So, you know, if you're living within millimeters of the surface of the leaf in the summer, that leaf, of course, is transpiring. So you've got, you know, water coming up through the roots. You've got that water coming out through transpiration in the leaf, right where those mites are at the surface, inside the tree canopy. You know, it might be, it might be 90 degrees and dry out in the ambient temperatures, or, you know, 80, whatever in the coast, you know, 80 degrees and relatively dry with no rain. But if you're a mite sitting by one of these pores in the inside of a tree, right at the surface of a leaf, that's a warm enough, humid enough environment for them to do well.
Okay, there was a question about sulfur. It says, the information I've read indicates that sulfur damages beneficials. So why is it recommended in California?
So sulfur damage to beneficials, I'll tell you, it's all over the place as far as what people say. You know, there's data out there that predatory mites do great in sulfur. There's other information that says they totally get fried by it. And I'm talking, you know, we're talking apple data from Washington. We're talking hops. We're talking, you know, lots of different crops, different pests. There's no one definitive answer that says sulfur is good or bad. You know, certainly if you're putting sulfur on in 100 degree weather in the middle of summer, it's hot. You know, so sulfur is a hot product. It fumes, and certainly it can have a certain effect on you know, on predatory mites and other things. You know, at the same time, sulfur in, you know, let's say in March, it's not going to fume as much. It's not going to be as hot of a product, and it's going to have a different impact. So, you know, can it ding some beneficials, and particularly predatory mites? It can, but you also have to look at what the alternatives are. You know, something like Fuji mite is going to obliterate predatory mites for a month, whereas sulfur might stunt, you know, knock them back or be a little detrimental to some of the smaller ones. So yeah, is it totally safe? No, but does it wipe them out? No. And when you look at different times of years and different temperatures and all, there's a big it depends component as far as how important that impact is.
Okay, and this was just a comment about the so much area-wide ACP spraying that citrus bud mite has virtually disappeared. And then another comment by the same person was that the ACP treatments are killing them.
Yeah, so the, you know, the whole ACP thing is new. And there's, you know, certainly there's the ACP treatments are going to help to control some mites like bud mites. ACP treatments are also going to have a negative effect on some beneficials, which of course could make some of the mite problems worse and some of the insect problems worse. You know, there's no one blanket statement on whether or not these, you know, ACP or sharpshooter treatments, you know, they're not uniformly good or uniformly bad. It just, it, you know, as the comments are starting to show, you know, sometimes it's better, sometimes it's worse. Like right now we're, you know, for example, with glassy wing sharpshooter up in the General Beale area, Asian citrus psyllid treatments have been the best thing in the winter for helping with sharpshooter programs. You know, at the same time, you know, those treatments are broad spectrum products that could have a negative impact on beneficials. So, you know, IPM is complicated. Citrus, more than any other crop, citrus is a monster food web with lots of pests. Every pest has a beneficial. Yeah, it's just this monster food web that as you impact one thing, you're going to impact the other thing and, you know, on and on down the line. So, you know, I'm doing my best to make some blanket statements about, you know, what's going on. And at the same time, individual experience could be very different just based on the area, your level of biocontrol, your programs, and so on.
Okay, this is the final question that we have, and it is, does compost tea control any mites?
So compost teas are interesting because compost tea, of course, is not a specific active ingredient. For example, how do you like your coffee, right? Or how do you like your tea? Do you put your tea bag in for 1 second, or do you leave it in for 10 minutes? And what kind of tea? Are you talking walnut hull tea versus something else? So there's no simple answer. There is some data out there that some teas have had some effect on some mites. But as far as knowing which ones affect which mites, I don't have that information. I mean, in most cases, they don't. In most cases, you're either going with a true miticide, sulfur, or oil. But there are other things out there. And yeah, some teas in some cases can help, but I don't know any that are mainstream. I don't actually know of any that are listed in any of the University of California's guidelines. So doesn't mean they couldn't work in some cases, but they're certainly not mainstream. Yeah, and last comment, I just saw the comment there from Jose Luis. Absolutely, he's right. Yeah, add soaps into that. I should say insecticides work, sulfur for some of the mites, soaps and oils. I'll put them into sort of a similar category. But yeah, especially for organic growers, those are some key options. So yeah.
Okay, great. All right. Well, thank you, David, for presenting.
Yeah, no, it's my privilege. Again, thanks for letting me do my best to try to summarize all these mites across a very broad geographic range. And I appreciate those of you that put some comments about your personal experiences into the chat.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you again, everybody. And I hope you all have a good rest of your afternoon.